Hi, thanks for tuning into this video, where I will demonstrate how you can do pre-deployment change validation with Batfish in an automated CI environment. What I'm going to show you is a live demonstration of a CI pipeline. The CI pipeline is built on GitLab for source control and for CI orchestration, Batfish Enterprise to be the actual CI engine, sort of running policies to evaluate your network, and then Ansible Playbooks to provide workflow orchestration. So what I've built out here is a leaf spine data center. So it's about 90 nodes. It's got a typical leaf spine data center architecture, the border leaf. So all the leaf spines and border leafs are Cumulus devices. I have a Juniper SRX as the firewall, and then two MX routers, Juniper MX routers as borders. So what I want to show you is a series of common actions that I might want to take in an automated environment as it relates to my network. So the first demo scenario is going to focus on adding capacity to the data center. Let's say I've got some new servers I want to bring online. I need to add a new leaf to that. So I've created a workflow around adding new leafs to my data center fabric that takes just very minimal user input. So let's kick that off. So I'm going to do that by running an Ansible playbook. And this just makes it easy for people using this workflow, because you can specify exactly what input you need from them and really minimize the amount of data they have to provide you. Makes it easy to adhere to templates, et cetera. So I'm going to give it my new leaf number. I'm going to give it the BGP ASN. And then everything else is computed based on that. So I hit commit. So the way my playbook is set up, this playbook is going to generate the YAML input files that I need to generate the config. So I have a series of Jinja templates that will then be combined with that YAML input. So I commit the YAML file into my Git repo. The templates already exist there. That's going to trigger a build in GitLab. That is then, once the config build is done, that is then going to trigger a policy evaluation in Batfish. So while the GitLab part's going, let's take a look at what the Batfish console looks like. So this is what's currently running my network before any change has been made. I see this topology of my network, my standard leaf spine, and I only have one snapshot there today, which is the current running network snapshot. Now I see a new snapshot has showed up. This is the result of that Git commit. We've worked our way through the CI pipeline, and the configs have been generated and sent to Batfish for analysis. So that green check mark means Batfish has finished parsing all the configs and building out all the data, the routing tables, the vendor neutral data model, et cetera. Let's look at the change real quick. So what did Batfish see in this change? Well, it saw that there's one new config file that was added for leaf 90. And I can actually click on that and see what it looks like. And you'll see, obviously, everything's new. You can see that I have a leaf 90. And this is a Cumulus config. Based on the format, I've got my FR configs and I've got my interface configs. All right, so let's see what Batfish had to say about the policy evaluation. So Batfish is analyzing a series of policies. As those policies get evaluated, I'll see the results in the dashboard. So right at the gate, I see that I have a failure. So I can actually troubleshoot this failure using the Batfish Enterprise dashboard. So I see there's two tests that have failed. One is no duplicate BGP AS, and one is that all leaf routers should have all host subnets. So it's more about routing and the propagation of routes. So let's dig into the first failure. So what I see here is leaf 90 and leaf 09 are using the same AS number, which is 65009. That's problematic because I built my data center design around eBGP only, and every device has a unique AS. So when I look at the next failure, I see leaf 90 and 09 are missing some host subnets. So they, you know, this is most likely the caused by this duplicate AS number, because I don't have allow ASIN configured on any of the BGP devices, because if all the AS numbers are unique, it's not necessary. So go back and look at the rest of my policy. So that's my only failure. Now, in this case, I'm pretty sure what the change is that I need to make to make this pass. So let's go back. I'm going to rerun that same playbook. And this is a common workflow, right? You make a commit, the tests fail. Now you go back and you say, okay, let me edit that commit to fix the test failure. So I'm going to go back and say, okay, I want to regenerate the configs for Leaf 90. I'm going to give it the correct BGP AS number. Sorry. Fix Leaf 90 BGP ASN. Commit message that is self-explanatory. And then there we go. So once again, what's happened here is the playbook has generated the YAML input I need and committed that to my Git repo. And the minute there's a commit, that triggers the Git CI pipeline. The first phase of that pipeline is actually building the configs. So it's using that YAML input plus the Jinja templates I have to build the configs. So let's go over back to the Batfish dashboard and see what it says about policy execution. I see the new snapshot has arrived and Batfish is analyzing it. All right, Batfish has finished building all the artifacts. Let's go back to the compare view again and see what was the difference. So I can see relative to the last snapshot, which I just pushed and this new change, the only thing that's changed is the BGP AS number. So that's what I would have expected. So now let's go look at the policy execution. So right away, I can see that my routing and routing protocol policies have all passed. So these are the ones that had failed before. So just for a quick recap, if I go to the previous snapshot, you'll see routing and routing protocol policies failed. If I go to the latest snapshot, you see that it passed along with some of these others. So at this point, I know this change is safe to make. So if I had connected this to a running network, I could have had a deployment phase of my CI pipeline, of my GitLab pipeline that would have pushed this to the network. But in this case, I'm just going to stop here. I validated the change. I know that it's good. I can take whatever action I want after the fact. So this is a use case where I was just going to I was adding capacity to the network. What I want to show you is another common workflow. So let's go back to my Ansible playbooks. And what I'm going to show you here is, you know, another common activity that a lot of our users tell us is, you know, they need to open up access to new IP subnets and new protocols, ports and protocols for new applications that are being rolled out in the network. And so that's obviously always a challenge. And so they'd like a streamlined way to do it. And so one way you could think about doing it is building a playbook, or it could be a ServiceNow form or a Python script that, you know, your app team can use to give you the information you need as a network team or a NetSec team to modify the network to allow that application to be deployed. And so here, I'm going to go ahead and say, okay, I need to provide access inside my network to a given prefix. In this case, I'm going to pick, this is the one the app team is telling me that they're going to run their set of services on, 10.100.10.0/24. Anybody should be able to access it. So it's an externally accessible service. It's running on TCP, it's SSL, and it's TCP port 443. And then I want the ServiceNow ticket ID, because what I can do is connect the results of my playbook execution and the Git commit and policy evaluation, all that data can get appended into this ServiceNow ticket. So it could also be some other IT SM solution as well, but ServiceNow is very popular these days. So I'm going to enter that. And again, similar to my last workflow, what this is going to do is I'm going to take the user input and I'm going to create the appropriate YAML data structures I need. And then I'm going to use a library called Kaperka, which is a vendor-neutral ACL and firewall rule language and framework. And I'm going to turn that into actual config text for my firewall. And what I'm doing here is the goal here isn't to automatically push this to the network right now. Is what I want to do is evaluate if the request from my app team is within policy for my network. And so that's what Batfish is going to help me do, is once these configs are built, it's going to evaluate the new network against the policies so that I know so I don't make any bad changes. So I can see the new network snapshot is in Batfish and is being analyzed. All right, Batfish has finished building all the routing tables and the forwarding models. Let's go back to that compare view. And what I can see is the compare view is giving you a series of differences between two snapshots that's curated across these different categories. So, you know, but let's go look at the actual config change. So the only file that's changed is my firewall config. And then this is showing me the exact lines that have changed. So, you know, as I would expect, I've created, you know, entries in my address book, created an address set, and then I've added another rule to my outside to inside zone policy. And then the term name is the ServiceNow ticket ID so that I can easily track things back. And, you know, it's just got my source desk IP, the application, so everything I'd expect. And this is all part of the Capirica framework that's generating these config lines and inserting them into my firewall config. So now let's look at policies. Did this change pass all my policies? So I can see that it passed most, but not all. So it failed my protect internal services TCP check. So let's look at that. And in there, there's seven assertions that I had. One has failed out of the seven. So we're suppressing the passing assertion. So let's look at the one that's failed. So I have a assertion that says there should be no reachability to my private subnets for newly initiated TCP flows from the outside. And what Batfish has done, and this is just a summary of what the information it possesses, is found a flow that actually succeeds. So I expected all flows to fail. I expected my network to not allow anybody to connect to this private subnet via TCP. But actually, I found at least one flow. And this is one example of out of all the flows that could get there. And so, but I also have information about the underlying query and analysis that Batfish did. So I can click on that link there. And now this shows me the data that Batfish has about this flow and why it succeeded. So this is useful. I can see that from the internet, I can get to this private subnet that sits behind Leaf 10. And I can see the ECMP paths through my network. And then on top of that, if I interrogate any one of these paths, I can see the input and output interface, why they were chosen, what routes were matched. And I can also see the filters that are evaluated that clearly permitted this packet to get there. So I can look at my border filter real quick. So it's got a term that says permit HTTPS. Okay, makes sense. Generically, I want HTTPS traffic to come into my network for my border. And then let me go back here and I'm gonna look at my cross-zone security policy. So I have a security policy for anything that's going to RE00. And I'm gonna click on that. And what's gonna show me is I'm permitting that because there is an explicitly permitted entry for this zone outside to zone inside. And so I know that this is a result of that change I just made. And so what I can do with this, I can go back to the application team and say, hey, you know what? The policy, the new subnet that you picked to deploy your app that resulted in this firewall change is no good because you picked the wrong subnet. You really shouldn't use 10.100, 10.0/24. You should pick a different one, right? So you can go and recommend a different subnet that they can use that's not supposed to be internal only. But what you have is this change did not make it into the network. So the beauty of it is, in a self-service way, the app team was able to request a change to the network. That change was automatically evaluated against network policies. And then you're giving data back to the network engineer or the NetSec team and the app team on why this change is not okay. Assuming it had passed, again, you could have automatically deployed this to the network, and then it would have been fully self-service for your app team. As soon as they were ready, they made the request passed policy, the network was updated. Now the network is no longer the bottleneck to rolling out new applications or moving applications or scaling applications. The network now truly can evolve at the speed of applications. So hopefully you found this demo interesting and exciting. Tune in for more of these. You know, we're going to continue to demonstrate new capabilities in Batfish Enterprise around how you can get pre-change validation, pre-deployment change validation with Batfish and Batfish Enterprise. So Thank you very much, and hope to see you again on our next video.